to declare to you, my past is over in you. All things are made new, surrendered my life to Christ. I'm moving, moving forward. Oh. What a moment you have brought me to such a freedom I have found in you. You're the healer who makes all things new. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Not going back, I'm moving ahead. I'm here to declare to you, my past is over in you. Things are made new.
Thank you, precious Father. Yeah. Thank you, precious Lord. Father God, we just want to thank you, Father, for allowing us to have air in our lungs, Father, so that we can praise you, the one and only, Lord.
Here I am before you, falling in love and seeking your truth, knowing that your perfect grace has brought me to this place. Because of you I freely live my life to you, oh God, I give. So I stand before you, God. I lift my voice 'cause you set me free. So I shine.
Proclaim that I am yours.
again with me.
So I shout out your name from
Jesus. You're so good, Lord. How many know we have the victory in Jesus? We already won that battle. Thank you, Lord.
When all I see is a battle, you see my victory. When all I see is a mountain, you see a mountain. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. Thank you, Lord. There's nothing to fear, for I am safe. So when I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high, oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night, oh God, the battle belongs to you. If you are for me, if you could be against me, yeah. Oh, Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. Thank you, God. God, you see the empty tomb.
Yes, Lord.
So when I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high, oh God, the battle belongs to you. And every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night, oh God, the battle belongs. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow, win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadow, win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in shadow, win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God.
Yes, Lord.
So when I fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high, oh God, the battle belongs to you. And every fear I lay at your feet, I'll see through the night, oh God, the battle belongs.
Jesus, Lord. Yes, Father, you are the way maker, Lord. You are the only way, the only one, Father, that has the power to make a way in all things, precious Father. Have your way in our hearts today, Lord. Have your way in this place. Have your way in our homes. Have your way in our lives, Lord. Thank you, precious Father, Lord Jesus.
Darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Even when we don't see it,
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop.
Come on, press it.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working.
Even, you know, that husband you've been praying for, keep pressing in. That son, that daughter that you've been praying for, keep pressing in. That one thing that nobody knows about that you've been praying for, keep pressing in. Because even when we don't see it, he's still working. Even when we don't feel it tangibly, he's still working. He's working. He's working. He's working. Do you believe that he's working?
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working.
Thank you, Lord.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop.
Waymaker, come on. Push in.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You never stop working. You never stop.
I want you guys to keep singing that. And as you're singing that, I want you to think about that one person that you've been praying about. Right now.
You never stop.
Because even though we don't see it and we don't feel it, He's working right now in that person's life.
I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working.
You know what's beautiful? I have to say this. You know what's so beautiful? Is that somebody never gave up on us. Somebody continued to press Him. Somebody probably sang that for us. Somebody stood in the gap for us. Somebody didn't stop praying. Because we would not be standing where we're at right now if they had given up. It's because of the prayers of others prevail much. And it's because of their love for us, their unconditional love. It's okay if people are not serving alongside with us. It's okay if people are not, but as long as they're serving the Lord, it's okay as long as they are have a relationship with Christ. We need to remember that we need to continue to pray for those. We need to continue to move on their behalf. Because a lot of the times we want things to be tangible. We want the tangible in our lives. But sometimes we don't see it and we don't feel it. But it's happening. It's happening. So just remember that it is happening. So when you feel that something's not happening, sing those lyrics. And I guarantee you and I promise you that you are going to hear a praise report. You are going to see something and God is going to show you and He's going to be real and make Himself real to you. Amen. Amen. Praise God. God bless you.
Welcome to our Sunday service here at House of Rest, where Jesus is the senior pastor of this church. We have a seat with your name on it. We appreciate you for spending your Sunday morning with us. Established in 2011 and going strong in the name of Jesus. Here is our weekly schedule. There's always something to do, so do something different. Each Monday, we invite you to evangelize on I and 9th Street in the city of Modesto with a House Arrest evangelizing team. At 6 p.m., we begin and we end at 8 p.m. Wednesday night teaching service. Join us for a time of worship and Bible study with Pastor David Rocha from 7 to 8 p.m. Also bring your youth for a biblical foundation study and great fellowship in the youth sanctuary. Friday night with Pastor Al for an intimate time in the scriptures in between the lines Bible study. You don't want to miss it. Ladies, every third Saturday of the month, join us for Sack Lunch Brunch. Pack your own lunch and fellowship over a spirit-filled brunch. Come be encouraged and uplifted, a perfect place for a woman of God to bond and build family, 10 to 12 noon in the lobby. Every fourth Saturday of the month, grocery giveaway between 11 a.m. and 12 noon. We really need your help in giving to our community. Volunteer to help at 9:30 a.m. and be a blessing and see how God works through your life in giving. Our vision statement is important to us. Number one, we love Jesus with no agenda. Number two, we teach identity in Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit with healing, deliverance, prophetic word, and biblical teaching. Number three, we teach to hear the voice of God. He still speaks today. Number four, before we are a church, we are a family. Thank you for joining us at House Arrest Church, Modesto. We are a Grace International Church with over 4,800 churches across the globe. Welcome home.
Good morning, everyone. How's everyone doing today? Amen. Yeah, well, it wasn't working at first. So it was muted. Hey, man, it's good to see everybody here. God bless you guys. It's good to be back. If you have no idea what I'm talking about, we were in Houston at the conference that we go to every year for Grace International. And it was a great, great time. But before we get into all that, let's meet and greet each other. If you see somebody you don't know, please introduce yourself for about 1 minute. Say hi to as many people as you possibly can. Make sure you don't forget the media. Those of you that are watching online, thank you so much for joining us. God bless you. It's good to be back. Hopefully you are blessed wherever it is that you're watching this from, whether in your living room, your car, your motel room, your jail cell. I don't know where you're at. But wherever you're at, God bless you. Thank you for being with us on this Sunday morning. God bless you. Amen. It's babies. All right. Real quick, before we go any further, I want to also make sure you continue to pray for Pastor Al. He had 3 surgeries this week. And he's recovering. He's watching online. He was having trouble logging on, but I sent him the link. And he basically went in for a tune-up. And, right? Yeah. Yeah, he's home resting, and I'm pretty sure that he's watching, but continue to pray for Pastor. That's a lot of surgeries back-to-back-to-back, 3 surgeries. But we pray in the name of Jesus for a fast recovery. In Jesus' name, faster than what the doctors say. And, you know, I mean, every surgery where you're taken under is dangerous. At no matter what age we are, no matter what. But 3? You know, that's a strong man you got. Amen. Also, we want to thank everyone that stepped in last Sunday for Sunday service. Sister Lydia, for preaching, for the worship team, for the ushers, for everybody that was helping. Also, Pastor Al preached the Spanish service with the help of Brother Saul. Thank you so much. And then my brother stepped in on Wednesday and gave a Bible study. And I heard, I still haven't had a chance to hear it yet, but I need to hear it. And it was good. Are you guys firing me now? Or just? Here's what's messed up is everybody said, hey, that's a little you. So the opposite of that means I'm the bigger him? Messed up, but okay.
I like this.
Now, my brother Angel, I think was saved like 10 years before me. And if you get us together, it's forget it. Just get a blanket, whatever, and we're just not going to stop that conversation. Yeah, so, but I appreciate, because he has a group, he has a house church that he's looking for a building in Manteca right now. And he has a Wednesday thing, so he invited those. He stopped his thing to be here for Wednesday, and I really appreciate what he did. Yeah. Amen. So what else? Go right into that? All right, guys, so we're going to remind you that we support missions. We're really excited because we were able to see Pastor Moses, Pastor Thomas, actually everybody on that whole board, Pastor George, Caleb, and Alyssa Mooney. And it was a huge blessing to be able to sit with them and be with them amongst other pastors and leaders that we know from around the United States and outside of the United States. But Pastor Moses from Uganda will be here next Sunday. You wanted to share something about that?
So I want to share about that, because what do we normally do, guys? If you're new, you won't know. But for those of us that have been here for several years, what do when we have Pastor Moses? And we have a feast. We call it the Feast of All Feasts. what we do is we choose, because it makes sense that for Pastor Thomas, it falls on Cinco de Mayo. So it makes sense. He loves Mexican too. So we'll be doing a Mexican feast for him for Cinco de Mayo, which is a different date. I just said Cinco de Mayo.
What if they don't know Spanish?
Anyways, 5th of May. And then for Pastor Moses, which is this coming the 21st of April, we want to do All American. That means you guys are open to bring an all-American meal, anything that you feel, you know, just don't go crazy on us and start bringing something different, you know. But try to stick with the theme would be really nice. And we are going to be doing a potluck. A feast is where everybody just brings a dish. I'm not going to say you have to make for everybody, no, because you better get to that dish before, you know, and make sure that you leave enough for everybody to share. But, guys, we do this every time. And, you know, I'll tell you one thing. Instead of us taking them out to a restaurant and spend money on a restaurant, they love this. They love getting to know all of you. They love talking to you guys. It reminds them of being at home. That's what it is. And they're like, we love this because this is what it feels like at home. They get together and they gather in big groups and they bring dishes and they share food and they do all of that. And this is what this is. So it's become a ordinary thing for us. Every single time we look forward to it, and we do a feast for them. We do different types of food every single time. So guys, if you'd like to, please sign up with me and Andrea or Jessica. You'll see each one of our heads. Please stop us and be like, this is what I'd like. I have my phone with me. I'll put it in. Just let me know what you'd like to bring, because we want to have a mixture of a little bit of everything, rice, beans, whatever. But no, not for that day. Sorry. I'm thinking Mexican. See, guys, we just literally drove back from SoCal. So. But anyways, All-American, whatever you want to do, All-American. Let us know. We'll write it down, and we will go from there. And was that all the announcements that I had? Yeah, I think so. All right, guys. Thank you.
Amen. And just because you pronounce a Spanish dish in an American way doesn't mean that makes it American. I'm not bringing taquitos, I'm bringing taquitos. Like, that doesn't make it. The what? Okay. All right. So, guys, we support missions. What we do is ask for $5. Your $5 gets split into 5 different ways to the 5 different ministries that you see on the screen. And I'm going to share with you a little bit more during the sermon about what it is that we do here and how it's reflected in Houston. Also, the offering and the tithing, we want to thank you also for continuing to support and be a part of this family. Those of you that are online, also, if you guys are getting fed here, if you're being discipled here, I know through a screen it's hard, but if it's something that you are growing, you know, please consider giving your tithe and your offering here at House of Rest to help us continue on and continue what it is that God is doing here. So if we could, there's different ways to give on the screen, Venmo, Cash App, Zelle, PayPal. And for those of you that are here, there's envelopes. If there's any ushers, they could give you an envelope. Or if you have an envelope and you don't want to walk it up, they will walk it up for you. And we just want to continue to thank you so much for just being a part of this family. If we could bow our heads, Lord God, we thank you for this opportunity. We give you all honor. We give you all glory. We thank you, Lord, for bringing Sharon and myself and the team that went with us, to bringing them home safely, Lord God, on the flight there and on the flight back. We thank you, Lord God, for all the people that we were able to talk with that we haven't seen in a long time, Lord God. We thank you for Pastor Thomas and Pastor Moses, Pastor George, for the Mooney family, Lord God, for our evangelism team, Lord God, and everything that God has set in place at the conference for the evangelism team, because it's getting people's attention, Lord God, and we thank you, Lord God, for that, Lord. We just give you all honor and all glory. Bless every single dollar that comes in, and let it be multiplied in your name, Lord. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. There's one last thing I did want to talk about. Ben, did you receive that flyer? Okay. So we had a beautiful family that used to be part of House Arrest and very dear to us. She was part of our worship team, and he was an usher, an amazing usher, a funny usher at that. And, you know, for maybe just for quite a little bit, they stepped away only. No, you're not able to. So because I know that she became ill. And in the interim of that time, her husband had a heart attack. And he passed away maybe about two, three weeks ago. And we're a family, guys. We are a family. And we are going to be having a celebration of life here on Saturday. And we're very honored that we're able to do that. And this is what family does. We come together and we honor the children of God. Amen. And I'm just really, really blessed that we're able to be able to have Rob's. His name is Robert Beach. And that we're able to have Rob's celebration of life here. And she wanted to open it up to the church family. So if you do know the Beach family, you are very welcome to be here to come and share in that special moment with them and that celebration of life with them. We will be canceling the women's event for this Saturday, but I do need help. I will need ushers that day. I will need a team, you know, to greet people. And if you don't have anything to do that day and you would like to be here and help and extend your hand, I can definitely use the help, especially when we host celebration of lives or when we have anything like that. You got to remember that we do this from our heart because this is the right thing to do. And I just want to extend that invitation that even if you did not know the family and you want to come and extend your hand and help, please come see me. I would love to have you come be part of that team. Amen. Okay, there's no flyer. I'll have him put it up towards the end, and we'll go from there. If not, I'll print one and I'll put it on the bulletin boards, that the one going up the stairs. I'll print a few of them and put them there, guys. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Ooh, I trust you, Lord.
I heard this song at the conference and I just had to sing it back home.
Blessed assurance. Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood, and what He did for me on Calvary. More than enough. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail.
trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. All is at rest. I know the author of tomorrow has ordered my steps. So this is my story, and this is my song. I'm praising my risen King. My Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. Sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him, God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. The Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why in God, my Savior, the one.
trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. Sing it again. Trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail, who will never fail.
If you play a music instrument of any sort, come out here, please. If you play any sort of music instrument, come out here. Something so beautiful. And he wants you to use your gift. There's such a beautiful thing when you usher in the presence that brings healing. You know, last year I realized, like, Lord, I may not be able to preach the way my husband preaches, and I may not be able to stand behind the pulpit and bring the word that way, but I know that there's a worship song inside of me, and that worship song inside of me, I know that it's like beautiful waves that go out, and it's gonna move hearts. He doesn't want you to sit on those gifts. We have not had anybody up here besides just the drummer and Ernie come up here. I wanna see those gifts flourish, have a desire to use them for the Lord. Because he wants to bring that out of you. Because that is going to be your way that you are going to reach the multitude, the way that you are going to reach those kids, the ones that you keep trying to talk to Jesus about. You are going to sing worship. There's music in your heart. And there's so much that needs to be brought out. Don't be afraid. Don't be shy. Don't be embarrassed. None of that, because he gave it to you so that you can sing praises unto him. And when you're up here, it feels so beautiful, because sometimes I forget that everybody is around. And it's just me and Jesus. It's just me and him. And it's such a beautiful feeling. So I encourage each and every one of you guys, brother, I encourage you guys to pick up that instrument. Take the time to come up here, because it is so beautiful what it does to the heart and what it brings. When I went to go see my sister, in the times that she would hear music, it made her soul alive. It gives life to people. Your music can bring life. Can we extend our hands and pray over them, please? Father God, I know, Father, that you have a plan for each and every one of these individuals that are here, our family, Lord. And I pray, Father, that every instrument, Father, that they pick up, Father, will be anointed, Father. And Father, we know that you are calling them, Father, to go to the forefronts, Father. We know that in the battle, Father, that it is the musicians, Father, and the worshipers, Father, that went out to battle, Father. But Father, your hand, Father, was upon them, Lord. Father, they ushered in such a beautiful presence, Father. And I pray right now for that presence over each and every one of them right now, Lord.
that you give them a desire like never before, Father, that you give them, Father, a special gift, Father, to just want to worship you, Lord, like never before. Let that be their mouthpiece, Father. Let that be everything, Father, that they want is to worship you, Lord. When they wake up, when they go to sleep, Father, they will touch hearts, Lord. And I thank you, Lord, because, Father, every salvation, Father, all of heaven rejoices for every salvation, Lord. And, Father, through the worship that each one of these young people and each one of these individuals, Lord, that when they pick up an instrument, salvation will take place, Lord. Healings will take place, Lord. Yes, Lord, restoration will take place in the hearts of those, Father. And we thank you, Lord, in the precious, mighty name of Jesus, Father. Thank you, Father. Raise up your army, Lord, your army of worshipers, Lord. Father, that we will pray and come together, Lord, and that we will build a team, Father, that is on fire for you like never before, that the word is strong, Father, within us, Lord, that we will eat the word, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we all say, amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord.
One last time, ready?
I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail.
Trust in you, precious Father, Lord Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah.
You know, before we have a baby dedication, but before that, I want to wish my mom a happy birthday. She's right there, probably in line back there. I'm not going to call her up here because I know she don't like to. She says, that's why I raised pastors, so they can be up front. Sierra. Sierra also has a birthday? Where's she at?
Probably went to you.
She's right there?
Oh, there she is. She's hiding right there.
You can come up. You have no problem coming up because I see you sing right there. Anybody else have a birthday coming this week or this last few days? Anybody else? Who? Eleanor, come on up. When is it? April 9th. Amen.
Yes.
Amen. Oh, he has a birthday?
Who has a birthday?
Elijah. So, yeah, we just got back. Well, we flew in from Houston to LAX on Thursday, and we ended up staying in LA to be with her sister who just lost her husband 2 weeks ago, and your older kids. And we literally just came into town for service. We just got back right now, and I hadn't had time to say anything to my mom about her birthday, you know. And but we wanted to, we always want to acknowledge birthdays, because this is a house, this is a family, you know. That's why we say that before we're a church, we're family. And Jesus is a senior pastor of this church, and this pulpit belongs to the Lord. And I've often said that we are just simply a house church that happens to be in a building, because that's what we wanted, is family, to be together. And both of you, thank you so much. Thank you for being a part of this family, sister. We've gotten to know you in a short time, and we just appreciate you and your hunger for the things of God. Young lady, we appreciate you too. That's a cool shirt, actually. We thank you for being part of worship and for singing, and for your help. You don't like being here? You stand right there and sing. It's different from singing, huh? All right. If I had a spotlight, we'd put it right on you right now, but we don't. Huh? Yeah. Amen. So with that, we're going to go ahead and sing Happy Birthday.
Amen. Let's stand, guys. Amen. Let's just stand. Amen. I know. I feel like I've been sitting for the last time making you guys stand with me. Feels good. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. And to the lady who's hiding out there somewhere. She got away with it this time. We'll get her.
Amen. Now we do have a baby dedication for Jack. Is Jack in the building? He has to walk up on his own.
How old? You got to come up too.
Somebody can fill.
Somebody can fill.
All right.
So, it's.
All right. Is other grandma here? Oh, I was going to say, you don't look like a grandma. Amen. So at this church, as most Christian churches, we don't baptize babies. We present them unto the Lord. We do that because in Scripture, even Jesus himself was presented. You know, and I'm on the wrong page here. And I just want to thank you guys, first of all, for choosing to do this here, because it's truly a blessing. In Matthew 19:13-15, it says, children were brought to him, to Jesus, that he might lay his hands on them and pray. And the disciples rebuked the people, but Jesus said, let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for to such belong the kingdom of heaven. And he laid his hands on them and went away. You know, to all of you that are here, the family is a divine institution ordained by God from the beginning of time. A child is a blessing from God to the parents to care, provide, protect, and train them in the way of the Lord. And it is good when parents recognize their obligations and responsibilities and make an effort to carry them out. This is why we're standing here in front of everyone that's here as witnesses to the promise that they are making for baby Jack. Amen. At House of Rest, we dedicate, like I said earlier, dedicate rather than baptize them. In the same way, Hannah dedicated Samuel, who became one of Israel's greatest prophets, and Joseph and Mary dedicating baby Jesus to the Lord according to Jewish custom. We believe baby dedication closely follows the biblical pattern for children. It's really important. I think he likes you. I know. In summary, this public acknowledgement is to recognize that Jack is a gift from God. and that you have a spiritual responsibility to nurture him in Christ. What's mom's name? Winter. Winter, you have brought Jack before us. Your name? Wyatt? It's your last name ain't Earp, is it? Okay. Just checking. That's a dad joke. Sorry, I can't help it. That's why you know. Yeah. I know you brought Jack before us today to publicly dedicate him to the Lord, but I have questions to ask you, and please affirm your desires by answering each of them by saying, "We will." There's three questions. Is will you accept your God-given responsibility to raise Jack in a Christian home? Amen. Will you teach and disciple Jack and not depend on the church or school system to teach him biblical knowledge and spiritual value he will learn at home? Amen. And will you be a living example for him as he grows on to live as a believer in Christ? Amen. You guys all heard it, right? To the congregation, to everybody that's here, will you as a community of faith support them in raising Jack by showing him the love of Christ? Amen. So what we want to do is pray over him, and then we'll pray over the family. Let's all bow our heads. Lord God, we thank you for Jack. He's a beautiful blessing from you, Lord. And we pray in the name of Jesus for a long life. We pray for health. We pray for good things to be before him. We pray for your presence to be upon him and for angels to encircle themselves around him at all times and keeping him safe, Lord. We thank you, Lord. We pray for visions and dreams from you, Lord, and for you to be his comforter, for you to be his savior, for you to be the one that he cries out to as he continues to grow old and just life happens, Lord. I pray over him. I pray over the entire family, Lord God, that you completely, Lord God, do something in their life like never before, that he, Lord God, show them and continue to show them that you love them, that you have your hand upon them, that you have your face upon their home, over their family, Lord God. I thank you so much for this moment because we dedicate Jack unto you, Lord God, because it is a blessing from you and we dedicate him back to you. We thank you, Lord, in Jesus' mighty, mighty name. Amen. Amen. We have a certificate for you guys. Let's give Jack a hand. I know. Amen.
Crazy people.
All right, watch that step. Thank you, guys. It's a beautiful thing, guys, to be able to dedicate children. Regardless of what this world says, regardless of what our government says, Jack is a gift from God. And he didn't become a gift from God when he was born. He was a gift from God when he was conceived. And we just thank God for that because it's God that said to be fruitful and multiply. It's God that gives life. Amen. Babies are awesome. As long as I don't got to wake up to feed them, they're awesome. Lord God, I thank you for this word. I thank you for this opportunity to share. Let your word be shared here, Lord. I thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, as you guys know, we were at the conference. It's our yearly conference. Grace International is a covering of pastors, and they just celebrated 90 years. 90 years of pastors. A lot of times I've came across some pastors or other leaders and they'll say, oh, I never heard of Grace. And here's the thing is that when I was looking for a covering in the beginning of this church, when I had 20 chairs in a basement, I wanted to find a place with a strong foundation, a biblical foundation, a Spirit of God foundation. And believe it or not, it's harder to find than you think. You know, and I was looking for a place that had a covering with a world view, not a United States view, because God is a God of this world, not a God of United States only. And I came across Grace International through my daughter's pastor in Tracy, which is Mission City Church, Pastor Doug, and he introduced me to Grace International. Quickly soon, I got to meet Pastor Thomas, and everything went from there. Every year, they have a conference, and recently, a few years ago, it got switched over to Houston. Pastor Steve Riggle was here a couple months ago, if you remember. He's the president of Grace International, and It was a huge blessing to have him here. You know, he is president of Grace. He's the fourth president of Grace in those 90 years. And he oversees over 5,100 churches across the world. And this is what I like. I remember the first time I wasn't sure about Grace. And I went to the conference. This time it was in Oceanside, close to San Diego. And I knew who he was because of the website. And I remember going, so I kind of knew some faces, and I knew that he was the president of Grace. I knew there was thousands of churches under him, and he travels the world, and blah, 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 all that stuff. And I walked into the lobby of the church, and there was, like, people drinking coffee and stuff, and he was just there hanging out. And I was like, whoa, you don't have bodyguards? He's not hiding in the green room. You know, because sometimes you get pastors, they pastor two churches and they're already in the green room with, with Secret Service around them. And he was just there, and I just walked up to him and just introduced myself. I said, I'm new to Grace International. And he's like, oh, good to meet you. And that was it. Really nice. And other people wanted to talk to him, and I just kept it moving. But I saw a humility. And not only in that, but I started to meet other leaders and other pastors. Like, I remember talking to Pastor Thomas, and in talking to him, you know, I said, oh, so you pastor in Nigeria? And he says, yeah, I pastor and have Project Hope there, which it's a school and all this stuff, right? And in conversation, I don't know how it came about, but I found out that he oversaw like 500 churches himself. And all these pastors that were just hanging around drinking coffee and whatever, you know, they're just like, oh, yeah, he has 200 churches under him. He has 600 churches. And I'm just like, why are these people acting normal? Because in America, like I said, you get one church over 1,000 people and they think they're rock stars. And I instantly gravitated toward Grace International because I said, this is my heartbeat. You know, this is where I want to be at. You know, and so we go every single year, and we go to the conference, and we were able to go and just be blessed. You know, it feels good to not to have to be the one worrying about the sound and lights and this and that, and just receive, and for my wife just to receive, and we had a team go with us. You know, Johnny and Diana went with us, and Sister Raven, Brother Joseph went with us, Armando went with us, Lorena, and Emilio. Did I say everybody? That's everybody I said? Okay. And it was just a blessing to be able to take a team. And we had Pastor Al. We're like, we're over here enjoying ourselves, and poor Pastor Al keeps getting cut open, you know, but he was on our heart. He came up every day, you know, every day he came up, you know, and but it was truly a blessing, which kind of leads me to what I want to talk about today, which is to look how far you've come. For those of you that are sitting here, I want you today to realize how far you've come. You know, and maybe in me sharing my experiences, maybe it helps you reflect on yours, on how far you've come. Because a lot of times it's so easy to forget. You know, when we flew out of LAX because it was cheaper. Some of you said, why didn't you just go to the airport in SFO or Sacramento? Each ticket was like $250 more. And there was nine of us going. It was cheaper to drive down to LAX. And another thing was the fact that every time, I know Sharon misses her older children who live down there. So it's a time to fly back on Thursday and stay there a few days so she can visit family. What we didn't know or anticipate was that her sister, because our brother-in-law lost his life in a horrible accident about 2.5 weeks ago, roughly. And this is somebody that's been in the family, I think, 22 years. So this is somebody Sharon considered her brother. And she happened, my sister-in-law happened to drive down to L.A., so she was there when we arrived back. And I hadn't seen her yet. I had talked to her on the phone. Sharon flew to Utah to spend time with her. I hadn't seen her yet. So this was my first time seeing her. What do you say when somebody loses somebody instantly like that? There's no words, right? And so as I sat there and we sat there and then she asked me a question, and I was no longer brother-in-law. I was now Pastor David, because she asked me a question of, if this is God's will, then why is he gone? How do you answer that one? And quickly, I quieted myself, and I said, Lord, I'm going to mess up if I just talk out of my own brain. Lord, you need to lead this conversation, because you know exactly what she needs to hear. You know, and I just began to speak, and I realized that it inspired this message, because I want to say the same thing, maybe a little differently, but to you guys is, I use an example in my life. Years ago, I was before I was saved, I was a bad guy. I was a bad boy. Many of us were, and I ended up in federal prison. It was there where I gave my life to the Lord, served 6 years, and then I got out a year later, started House of Rest in my house. But during that time, when you do years, and I know many have done many more years than that, but nevertheless, they say psychologically, anytime somebody does more than 5 years, like, it does something to you. And for me, I could say this, is that after time, it becomes the reality. And the people outside, the family, the friends, it becomes a blur. And I can speak from my experience of this, is that it literally becomes a haze and almost a dream. And after a few years, I start to think that you guys aren't real. It feels like this is my reality. This concrete, this cell, this bunk, this is reality. The chow hall, the inmates, the weight pile, this is reality. And when I would watch television and I would see commercials, I remember tripping out on like a Chevy commercial, because it would show a car driving along the coast. And I'm like, that's not real. It was almost as if the free world didn't exist anymore. And I don't know if our brains do that out of survival, because it's hard to fathom that. And I think sometimes our brains do things in order for us not to go into a straight-up panic attack. And the free world becomes unreal and a fantasy. But here's the thing that everybody had, well, not everybody, everyone I was around had a release date. And it was the strangest thing to be with somebody. You're in a group, you're studying a word, you're making spreads, you're walking the track together, and all of a sudden that person's date comes up. And it is the oddest thing, because remember, the outside world doesn't exist. And it was the oddest thing that when that day arrived, it was that morning, they would release them about 6 a.m. And we would see them off. And I still remember seeing them walking toward the gate, that weird gate that people disappear to, and we never see them again. And I remember seeing so many good brothers walk to that gate as they wait for the gate to buzz. And then, like that, the gate buzzed, and they disappeared, and they were gone. And it was so weird, because I'm just like, man, last week we were joking. Yesterday we were eating together, and now they're gone. Like, they're gone into that fantasy world that's out there. It doesn't make any sense to me. But yet, in the pit of my stomach, it was going to be me someday. You see, every person here, you or I, we are like groceries with an expiration date. And the thing is that you don't know what it is. I can't turn you around and see the date on the bottom of your foot. But nevertheless, we all have an expiration date. And we're all going to be at that gate of eternity. And I remember thinking that I was sad that that friend was leaving. But realistically, that would have been selfish because they have people that love them on the other side. They have people that are anticipating for them to come home. But for us in the prison, it was so hurtful, it was so painful. We would gather together that night, and there was a void in the group. And it felt odd. And the fact is this, is that eternity is more real than this room right now. And for many of us, people are waiting for us to come home. I'm not trying to hurry and get there. But nevertheless, this is the reality. And while we're here in this life, a lot of times it feels like we don't notice how far we've come. You know, I want to read in Philippians chapter 3, 13 and 14, it says this. The Apostle Paul says, "Brothers, I do not consider that I've made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining toward what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." There's many times that, you know, when God has given you a vision, a mission, a ministry, like you see it and you've pressed toward the prize. And the honest truth is this, is that many times I've ran toward that and many times I've crawled toward that. And I think that's normal in our life. You know, that my thing is this, is God, I might not always be sprinting toward the direction you want me to go because I'm only a human, Lord. I said, but I promise you, I won't backpedal. If I got to crawl, I'm going to go forward. And a lot of times in our walk, we got to crawl. But when you crawl, it doesn't feel like you go so far. You know, yesterday we were going over the grapevine, and it started snowing up there. And it was really windy. So it was like a real blustery. I don't know if that's the right word, but it was really strange because here in Modesto, we're not used to snow. And yeah, we're used to going to the snow once the snow's on the ground up in the Sierra Mountains. But when it's actually coming down and you're driving, and, you know, everybody had to slow down. And the thing is this, is that I got to where I was going, but sometimes through the storm, you're going to slow down. And I think that speaks of our life also. And there's no reason for us to allow the enemy to discourage you, to make you think like, oh, you were running yesterday, oh, now you're crawling. And the fact is this, is that God never says you will not have storms in your life. The storms in your life, they come. But here's the thing. If you're in the middle of a storm, if you just stand still, eventually that storm will pass over you. Let me say that one again. If we stand still, the storm will pass. If we stand still. But nevertheless, you got to look at how far you've gone because we were going so slow over the grapevine and it felt at a snail's pace. But eventually we started to go down and reach the bottom. And that's the fact of that, is that eventually, no matter what, you're going to reach where you need to go. And nothing is going to change that. And we have to keep focused on that because, you know, I was really surprised because, you know, we do our little dollar thing for missions. And I'm going to tell you, The very first time, years ago, when we decided to do that, we said we're going to pick up dollars for missions because we want to take those dollars to conference. And I don't remember what exactly happened. I'll probably butcher the story, but that's okay. But basically, we didn't get a chance to gather it, to make it bigger bills, to make it into a check. No, we just took two Ziploc pillows of dollars. Because the year before, they picked up for missions, and we were broke. Like, we barely got there. But this time, we came with two Ziploc bags full of dollars that the church had given over the past few weeks, and we're just like, man, we're going to give toward missions. And I remember that it was missions night. One of the missionaries preached, and it's the only time they ever pick up a tithe in the whole conference in all the years I've gone is just for missions. And they go all out with the conference. It's a free conference. They're not passing buckets around, nothing, until it comes to missions, because that's their heart. And I remember that bucket came, and we pulled out our two pillows of dollars. Yeah, we sat in a balcony way in the back and make sure nobody is watching. Because at that time, we had an even smaller building than this. I think that church at that time would probably fit in that lobby. I think that lobby was bigger than that church at that time. And, you know, we're like rubbing elbows, even though the pastors are humble. But we were embarrassed because these pastors were like, they had nice, beautiful buildings, you know, and we had like this little warehouse that we made into a church. So we were embarrassed, you know, and we're just like, man, they're probably giving like $1,000 checks or who knows what they're giving. And we just got these little pillows of dollars. And so we didn't want nobody to see. And I just remember I held her hand and we prayed over the dollars before we dropped it into the bucket. And I said, Lord, multiply this in Jesus' name. And that started the whole dollar thing. And I remember after that, we said, we're gonna do a dollar a person, a dollar a week for Pastor Thomas. And so we did that whole year, picked up dollars. And I would be like, yeah, instead of a venti, get a grande and put that $1 in. That's all you got to do, simple. And then the next year, we met Pastor Moses, the one that's going to be here Sunday, and we said, let's do $2. And there we go with our little dollars. This has been many, many years. Now, we've always thought, I don't know about Sharon, I've always thought like, man, you know, they probably laugh at our little dollars that we gather, you know, because we gather them in every quarter, whatever gets picked up, we send to Pastor Moses, these go directly, like Grace doesn't take nothing of it. They give, whatever dollar amount you give, they get. And, like, I could even call Moses and say, hey, did you get that? And he'll say the exact amount that we sent through Grace. So, been doing this for years. In the middle of the conference, Pastor Steve Riggle's talking there. Must have been 2,000 people in there. Pastors and leaders from all over the world. And in the middle of that, he says, is David Rocha here? And my face turned red, right? I started sweating. And I'm like, what is going on? You know, am I being punked? Like, what's happening? And I stand up thinking, like, I'm just going to stand up. And he's, no, come on up here. So I walk up there, and I said something dumb. I said, like, I don't got a tie on. Like, that's what came out of my mouth. I don't know. Anyways. And I didn't know he knew this, but he starts to share how for the first 3 years of House of Rest, I was an Uber driver. And I would work until 2 a.m, and then I would come and preach. And if some of you have been around that long enough, I was always tired. You think I'm tired now. I was always tired, you know. And he says, in the midst of you, David, working Uber, you would give to, what would you do? I said, well, we started a story. And Pastor Thomas was sitting like in the first row. And he said, Pastor Thomas, stand up. And everybody starts clapping because of the dollar we gave him. I said, well, a year came, and then we started to give the Pastor Moses. And Pastor Moses stood up, you know. And I was going to keep going, but I got really nervous. I hadn't been nervous in years, but I was nervous. And I didn't mention Pastor George. I didn't mention the Moonies. And he's basically said, House of Rest in Modesto is an inner city church. And if they can do this, he goes, what if we all did this? And at that point, after that moment from the whole conference, like so many people were just being so hospitable toward us. And asking how we do it and asking those things. And then Pastor George from India spoke actually after that. And he says, hey, he goes, David gives a dollar toward us too. So he mentioned it. And then we talked to the Moonies after. And my thing is this, is I remember going that first time with those, the very first time I went, before I even knew Sharon, I remember I ate Jack in a Box with no cheese to get over there. I had enough gas to get home, had no gas for the hotel, so I was going to sleep in my car because it was the night I was going to be ordained to be the pastor of this church, and I wasn't going to miss it for nothing. And I remember going, and I was so exhausted, and I drove there, and I stood up and amongst other pastors, and I was ordained, and then afterwards, I was able to buy a Jumbo Jack meal with no cheese, and I drove back completely exhausted. I didn't stay the whole conference. I went to the ordination and left and drove all night all the way home. And as I was standing there, because I remember thinking, what am I doing? These guys are pastors for 30, 40, 50, 60 years, and I'm over here like with Jack in a Box in my stomach. You know, and I'm just like, what am I doing here? And I remember as years later, I remember talking to Sharon, and I remember telling her, I said, one of these days I'm going to speak at that conference. And then they did these, during the day, they have these breakout session classes, you know, and I remember thinking also, like, one of these days I'm going to teach one of those classes. And I did this last time they asked me to teach a class. And I think of all the struggles that as a church that we have gone through, from the basement, from 20 chairs to buildings, and sometimes losing a building, and then the church coming, and sometimes losing families we love, and sometimes never even understanding why. But then it's like it sets you back, and then you just got to keep going forward. And after a while, you're just like, you start thinking like, what am I doing here? But then God will turn you around, and you realize how far you've come. Some of you in your walk, you're just like, man, I'm struggling every day. I don't even know what I'm doing. But then God will turn you around and you realize, man, I used to be way over there, but now I'm here today. Because I am going forward. I'm doing one thing. I'm forgetting what lies behind, and I'm straining forward to what lies ahead, and I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. And we go forward and we don't stop. Some of you want to give up. Turn around and see where you came from. Turn around and see what God got you out of. And the fact is this, you ain't at the gate yet. So there's still some ways to go. But nevertheless, turn around and see how far God has brought you. And some of us need to be reminded of that. But there's a warning in there. See, when Moses came and all the plagues happened and the angel of death came and they went through the Red Sea. See, Moses' job was to take the people to the land that was promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And his job was to bring them into the promised land that God had given them. And what happened was they finally made it. See, there's a thing, if you know in the Bible, that Moses and them, they had to wander in the desert for 40 years. It doesn't take 40 years to go from Egypt to the promised land. It doesn't take 40 years to go from your crack house you were at to ministry where God wants you. It doesn't take 40 years to get you from that bottle of alcohol to the place where God has placed you. But nevertheless, it took them 40 years. Why? Why is that? Moses took them to the promised land right there at the border. And he says, you know what? Since we're 12 tribes, let us send a spy from each tribe to go and check out the land, which is smart. It's a smart thing to go and check things out before you go there. And the 12 spies got sent, one from each tribe of Israel, and they're anticipating and they're waiting. And the 12 spies went into the land to check things out. It says in Numbers chapter 13, verse 17, Moses sent them to spy out the land of Canaan and said to them, go up into the Negev and go up into the hill country and see where the land is and whether the people who dwell in it are strong or weak, whether they are few or they are many, and whether the land that they dwell in is good or bad, and whether the cities that they dwell in are camps or their strongholds, and whether the land is rich or poor, and whether there are trees in it or not. Be of good courage and bring some of the fruit of the land. Now the time was a season of the first ripe grapes. So he says, I want you to go and just see everything, because we don't want to go into a place blindly. And that's the way we should be, right? When God says, I want you to go here or go there, he gives us intellect. He gives us our brains so we can say, well, let me check things out first. See, the first time I remember, I thought I was going to come out and start a church in Tracy because I was born and raised in Tracy. And many times God said no to me. Now, I could have forced it, but then God would have said, what are you doing? And I remember, I was like, well, I'm confused. Then where am I going to go? And one time I was driving off 99 coming from Merced, and I the Lord said, get off right here on Tuolumne. And I drove downtown. He goes, this is where I want you to be. You're going to be a beacon of light in the city. And I said, I don't know anyone in Modesto, though. He says, but I do. So obviously, this is what I did. I said, okay, Lord. And I remember coming back that week a few times by myself. And I drove the city. I wanted to see. I wanted to see whether there was camps or strongholds. I wanted to see whether the people were strong or they were weak. I wanted to see whether the land was rich or poor, whether there was trees in it or not. I wanted to see. I'm like, God, if you're calling me there, then I'm going to check things out. And I remember doing that very thing. But then the spies came back. And when they came back, everybody was in anticipation and they were waiting. And it says in Numbers 13, 25, at the end of 40 days, so they were gone for 40 days. And at the end of 40 days, they returned from spying out the land, and they came to Moses and Aaron and to all the congregation of the people of Israel in the wilderness of Paran at Kadesh. And they brought back word to them and to all the congregation and showed them the fruit of the land. And they told them, we came to the land to which you sent us. Oh, man, it flows with milk and honey. And this is its fruit. However, the people who dwell in the land are strong, and the cities, they're fortified and very large. And besides, we saw the descendants of Anak there. So they're like, man, it is beautiful there. It is awesome there. But there's giants there, and the cities are fortified. The strongholds are strong. And I remember thinking that too, because I'm from Tracy. Tracy's a small town. And Modesto, even though when you compare it to L.A. or something, it's small, but nevertheless, for me, it was a big city. And I'm like, how am I going to do anything here? Because it looks like the city's strong. It looks like the opposition and the strongholds of demonic strongholds are well established. What am I going to do? Who am I? But nevertheless, I'm like, not my will, but your will. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. Lord, if you're telling me to go there, then I'm going to go there. Because I don't want to be like what we're about to read. In verse 30, but Caleb quieted the people before Moses and says, let us go at once and occupy it, for we are well able to overcome it. I love that. So they're coming and say, man, It's almost impenetrable. It's almost impossible. There's no way to do it. And Caleb says, yeah, I know all that, but you know what? Let's get what God told us to get. Let's take what God told us to take. Because I don't walk by faith. I walk by faith, not by sight. Because if you continually live your life by what you see, you're going to miss your blessing. You're going to miss the mission that God is sending you on. And he says, let us go at once and occupy it. I don't care if there's giants there. I don't care if there's fortified cities. If God, I saw God open the Red Sea, and if he can do that, then he can do anything. See, many of us, we forget. How many of us were completely wrapped in the sin that we had before we gave our lives to the Lord? We were like mummies in our vices, and God broke you free of it. And he didn't even have to work hard to break those chains off of you. They were like just little threads. They were like a spider web. It was nothing to God. What you couldn't break off yourself, he just blew on you and those chains fell. But then when he says, this is what I want you to do, then we start hesitating. Then we start second guessing God. Instead of saying, man, I was the worst of the worst, and you set me free, so surely if you're telling me to do that, you're going to set that nation free too then. But we forget, huh? Caleb didn't forget. He's like, no. I saw that Red Sea open. I saw what God did. I saw the plagues happen. I saw it. I know the promises of God. And even though this looks impossible to get through, my God, with my God, nothing is impossible. Let's take it. Let's take what's ours. It was promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And because of that, it's our promise too. Then the men who had gone up with him said, we are not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we. So they brought to the people of Israel a bad report of the land that they had spied out, saying the land through which we had gone to spy it out is a land that devours its inhabitants. And all the people that we saw in it are of great height. And there we saw the Nephilim, the sons of Anak who come from the Nephilim. And we seemed to ourselves like grasshoppers. And so we seemed to them. The other 10 spies, because Joshua was like, Caleb, I like the way you're talking. So Caleb and Jacob, Josh, am I getting it wrong? Is it Jacob or Joshua? Thank you. I just came from LA, sorry. But the other 10, they're like, you're crazy. There's no way we can do this. It's impossible. There's no way this can happen. And the congregation raised a loud cry. And the people wept that whole night. And all the people of Israel grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The whole congregation said to them, Would that we had died in the land of Egypt. Would that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would that we had died in the wilderness. Why is the Lord bringing us into this land to fall by the sword? See, a lot of times when things get hard, we all start to think that our past life was easier. God saves us. He delivers us. We're on fire for the Lord. And he says, all right, now I got you. Now go forward. And the first opposition you see, you're just like, oh, man, it was so much easier when I was doing this and doing that. See, this is what the people did. You know how many people, thank God, none of my friends, none of my brothers in Christ, but when they hit that gate, they never went back. But there are some. I remember going to a halfway house. My last 6 months, I had low points enough to go to a halfway house in Oakland. So I didn't have to serve those last 6 months in prison. I was able to go to Oakland, which I was able to get a job and have my car and sort of have freedom. And there was this man there. I didn't know him. He did 15 years. He didn't know how to function, so within a week, he robbed the bank on purpose and got caught on purpose so he could go right back. Because he came out and saw the giants, came out and saw this big city, came out and saw and says, I can't do this. And he purposely went to rob a bank in Oakland, knowing he would go back. because he couldn't handle it, because all he saw were giants. But that man, I don't know his life, but I can tell you this, that he did not have the Lord with him, because if he had had the Lord would have strengthened him. The Lord would have said, no, 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 you keep going. You don't have to fight these battles. I'm with you. In the valley of shadow of death, I will fear no evil because thou art with me. And there's, I can honestly, I believe there are many people that come out and do that. And in the same way in the Lord, the same thing happens. We get discouraged and we get beaten up and we start second guessing ourselves. And next thing you know, we start crying all night because we don't see a way out of it. We don't see any way that we could do anything. And they started to grumble. And then they said in verse 3, why is the Lord, and I'm in Numbers 14, verse 3. And they said, why is the Lord bringing us into this land to fall by the sword? Our wives and our little ones will become prey. Would it not be better for us to go back to Egypt? And they said to one another, let us choose a leader and go back to Egypt. This is what's crazy about it, is they're standing right there at the border of the promised land, that everything God had promised them all the way back from Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And all they have to do is take a step of faith into it. But it's weird that the fact that in the midst of the fear of the unknown, that they would rather walk all the way back than take one step. And a lot of us do that, and I don't understand. Not you guys, because you guys are awesome. But I've seen other people do that. God has blessed them. God has blessed their family. Maybe they didn't have a job, and now they have a job. They didn't have their marriage, and now they have a marriage. Their kids were wayward, but now their kids are on a worship team. And they're like, everything's going good. And God's like, okay, now I'm giving you a mission. Take that step. And you're like, oh, but it's scary there. Maybe I should just go back. And we say, wow, but you know how many lives I've seen just completely fall apart, and they choose to go back, and the kids go wayward, and they choose to go back, and the marriage falls apart. They choose to go back, and they go back to their addictions, and they lose the job that they got. And then they sit there and they'll say, why has God done this to me? See, I thank God that God has new mercies for us each and every day. So if this is you, you need to repent. Need to repent and say, you know what, man, the enemy got he got me. He got me on one good. But you know what? I'm not serving you, Satan. I'm going to repent and I'm going to walk my way back to where I was. And God has, he says he has new thoughts, good thoughts for you each and every day and toward your future. This is why the Hebrews wandered for 40 years. Because God says, if you are going to be fearful, then I will wait for the next generation and I'll let you die out. You know, I don't know about you, man, but I want to see God move in my generation. I don't want God to say, you know what, David, you're fearful, so I'm going to let you preach a little bit. But you know what? I'm just going to let you be there and wait for the next generation. Do I want good things for the next? Yes, of course I do, but I want to see that stuff too. I want to see salvations. I want to see deliverance. I want to see healings. I want to see massive revivals in the streets. I'm not trying to wander no wilderness for 40 years. It was right there. And God was like, fine, I'll let you wander. I'll let you go in circles. I've heard so many people, and this is heartbreaking, because I see ministry in you. I see ministry in you. But you continue to walk the desert. And there's nothing I can do for you. There's nothing I can do for you. And you say, man, I'm just waiting on God. No, God is waiting on you. What are you talking about? Souls are being lost. People are being lost. The gospel needs to be preached. He says that the harvest is plenty and the workers are few. Where are my workers at? You know, I remember eating a lot of fast food. Can you tell? And after a while, man, don't you get tired of it? But you know what's weird? Is that you get in this weird little fast food world where you're like, oh, I'm going to go to Carl's Jr. because they have this crispy bacon, cheddar, whatever burger, and you go there, and then you're like, oh, this is good. And then Taco Bell has, they added some chalumpana or whatever. They'll make names up. Those ain't Mexican names. They just make them up. And then so you go over there to Taco Bell, and you get this, and it's constantly this fast food. They're all trying to limited edition this, limited edition that, and you're just bouncing around, but you're not eating nothing. Nothing. None of that is good for you. But you get caught in this little world of the latest commercial, the latest new product they have. You know, and what happens is you forget there's a kitchen in your house. And the food you make is probably 10 times better than what you buy. We're going to get there someday. And what happens is we become a fast food society. And we don't know what a good home-cooked meal tastes like anymore because we're so busy and we're chasing after those things in the latest snack or the latest whatever commercial you get, the latest billboard off of Highway 99. You notice good restaurants don't really get billboards because they don't need it because their food speaks for itself. So if you see an ad, billboard, it's because they need you to see it because they can't win you over with quality. And you get stuck in this, and then after a while you get blind to it, and you think that's all there is fast food, and it doesn't help where every city you go to is the same fast food places over and over and over. Like, that's one thing in Texas. I told her I don't want to eat nothing that I could eat in Modesto. I want some Texas food, you know. I don't want to eat nothing. You know, and she's like, I'm barbecued out. I said, I'm not. Because next week I'm going to regret not eating that brisket. You know, and the thing is this, is that church has become this. Church has become fast food. Church has become this nice little beautiful billboard that looks nice and the bread looks fluffy and the lettuce looks crispy, but it's just an ad. And it's not even real. And you start going to church, and it's all fast food. And you're just, so you start comparing fast food to fast food. And after a while, you start getting disenchanted with it. And you're just like, man, all this stuff is the same. Everything tastes the same. Everything's bland. Everything's from the freezer. Everything's freeze-dried. These weren't even beans. They were flakes, and they added water. Somehow it's beans again. Like, this is weird. You know, and you live in this fast food world in the fast food church. And my thing is this, is that, you know what, I ate at places in Texas or in any times I've traveled to other places, and I'm like, I've never tasted nothing like this in my life. And you know why? Because it's not a chain. Because you can't find it anywhere else. You know, yesterday we went with your son to a restaurant that his boss took us to. And it was Mediterranean, and it was food I'd never seen in my life. And he's like, do you like Mediterranean? I was like, well, from what I've eaten, but I'll eat whatever you have. You know, I'll try a little bit of it. And, man, Mediterranean people get down. It was a big old round table, and they kept bringing food and, like, little bits, but of all kinds. I don't know how many things there was there. It was a lot, but I'm just like, I've never tasted this before. I never tasted, you know, and he's like, yeah. He goes, and even with Mediterranean restaurants, you'll never taste this because this is this restaurant, how they make things. See, here's the thing, right, is I remember something a long time ago a pastor's wife told me from Grace International when they were praying me in, and she had a word, and she says, Pastor David, she goes, the Lord is saying he's sending you to Modesto in a city full of religion, in a city full of people that know Jesus, but everybody's teaching them religion. And I want you to go and be separate from them. And as much as you feel alienated, as much as you feel like you need to do things the way they do things, God does not want you to do things the way they do things, because he wants you to be one of a kind, because God is going to do something special in the city of Modesto. And all you got to do is stick to what it is that you're doing and don't try to copy anybody else. I don't want a fast food church. And maybe things ain't perfect the way other places are. But this is some home-cooked meals. This is some home-cooked meals. There ain't nothing freeze-dried. I wasn't driving from L.A. and I'm like, okay, let me bring up a sermon from last year, something they haven't heard or they forgot. I'm just driving this morning. I'm like, give me a word. Because nobody wants no fast food. You guys are spoiled. You guys got used to some fresh food. You know, and it's like we have to realize, guys, that the pastor, Steve Riggle, I know it's getting late. I'm going to finish right here. See, Pastor Steve Riggle, when he came 2 months ago and we took him to eat after, and he was so blown away by you guys. You know, and you got to mind you, he pastors a church of 2,000 in Houston, which is probably really small in Houston, you know, but. It was nice him being the president of Grace International, him pastoring a 2,000 people church himself, and he's sitting there having lunch with us, and he goes, man, God is really, he goes, David, he goes, I go to a lot of Grace churches. He goes, God is doing something in Modesto. God is doing something in Modesto. He goes, I've seen this before. Now, that had weight to me. That had weight to me, but nothing like what I was going to hear when I was in Houston this last few days. You know, he started a church at first in Livermore many, many, many years ago, and it was a small, small building that was probably the size of our lobby. And that started to grow, and it grew to what is now, this church is still there in Livermore with Pastor Larry, and now seats, I think, 600 to 800 people. And then he moved to Houston, South Houston, and started a church there. And that church has a seating capacity of 20,000. And I'm like, that's insane. That's a lot of people. And then he started having multiple services because people wouldn't fit. So then he raised up a pastor because he says, I don't want to pastor a mega church. So he raised up a pastor, Pastor Garrett, and he says, here, you pastor that church. I'm going to start a church in North Houston, which is like 45 minutes north, which is where we went. That church fits 2,000 people now. And he says, they have multiple services, and they just right now just announced that they're going to build a bigger auditorium to hold 6,000. And now here's the thing. I do not want that. I don't want that. I don't want that headache. I don't want that. But I will say this. When I talk to him and he says, God is going to do something great in Modesto, it has weight. When Pastor Thomas comes up to me, pastors 500 people, 500 churches, 500 ministers in Nigeria, and he says, Pastor, he goes, God is doing something great in Modesto. I feel it from Africa. God is doing something great there. When Pastor George from India, who God gave him a vision of a Bible college, and now there's thousands of, it's the biggest seminary Bible college in all of India. And that's Pastor George because of a vision that God gave him. And he says, man, God is doing something in Modesto. And I'm just like, man, this is insane. This is insane because here's the thing. I'm not trying to follow after them, but I'm saying is that men that have shown, that have solidarity, that have shown their foundation and their walk over decades. And there's many pastors in that conference, but they make a beeline to us. It's like, God is doing something beautiful in Modesto. I don't know what you're doing, but keep doing it. Keep doing it. Keep doing it. And that causes me to turn around and look back and see all the everything that we've gone through, all the storms, all the troubles, all the heartbreak, all the betrayals, all of that. But I'm just like, you know what? I'm not looking back. I'm looking forward because I'm pressing toward the prize that Jesus Christ has for us and what God is going to do here. And I realize even more now And there's something Pastor George, the one from India, said. God told him, you're going to preach the gospel to every person in India. And he says, wait a second. He goes, there's a lot of people in India. I don't know how many hundreds of millions of people. He goes, Lord, if I get a building of 1,000 people, it will take me 1,500 years to preach to everybody. And he says, no, God, no, you're wrong. And it's funny, I can't remember exactly how he said it. Were you there when he was saying that? And then he said, God, he goes, that's impossible. I can't live 1,500 years. And the Lord said, no, but if you multiplied yourself and raised up 1,000 pastors, you can, I can't remember the number, but he says, you can do it in 2 years. He was, if you raise up pastors and leaders. And when he said that, it struck a chord in me. Because this is exactly my heart and my vision. This is why we have the Bible college. This is why the main meat of this church is our Wednesday Bible study. Because I want to raise up pastors. I do not want to hoard 2,000 people in a building. What I want to do is be able to equip people, whether you're evangelists or apostles or whatever it is, and send you out and be able to preach the gospel and do it in a biblical way with a biblical foundation and reach this city. Because if we want to reach Modesto, so that's 300,000 people. We couldn't fit them here. Nor do I want to. But God is saying, David, that struck a chord in you because I'm giving you the same calling and you're going to raise up pastors too, because by yourself you can't do it. But when you raise up multiple people, you will bring revival not only to Modesto, but it'll start to pour out in the Central Valley. It'll start to pour out to the Bay Area. It'll start to pour out in Los Angeles. It'll start to pour out across this nation. It'll start to pour out and get the attention of Nigeria, Uganda, South Africa. I had a South Africa pastor tell me, when are you going to come and preach the gospel in South Africa? Because people need to hear the gospel. We could all please stand. There was a man named Gideon, and he had 32,000 soldiers because God told them to raise up and go against the enemies of Israel. 32,000 soldiers. And God told him, that's too many people. I want you to leave some behind. And I imagine, because you would think, okay, if I'm supposed to fight, I need to get as many soldiers as I could possibly get. And the Lord says, no. He goes, because if you do that with all 32,000 people, and when you win, you'll think it's because of you. When I give you a mega church and everything happens, you'll think because of you. When I give you a really big ministry and things happen, you'll start to think that it was because of you. The Lord took 12 people, and one of them betrayed Jesus, and he turned the world right side up with 11 people. God took in a man named Paul, whose name was Saul, that was going around arresting Christians. And God says, I will turn you around, and you will reach the entire outside area of Greece and Rome. And God says, take the people to the water. And the ones that drink, looking around, keep those. And the ones that drink water, not being alert, send them home. And out of the 32,000, only 300 were looking around. And the Lord said, send the rest home. And God, and Gideon was like, how are we going to win? He's, you are never going to win with the 32,000. You're going to win because I am with you. In Judges 7:2, the Lord said to Gideon, the people with you are too many for me to give the Midianites into their hand, lest Israel boast over me, saying, my own hand has saved me. Now, therefore, proclaim in the ears of the people, saying, whoever is fearful and trembling, let him return home and hurry away from Mount Gilead. Then 22,000 of the people returned and 10,000 remained, and that's when he took them to the water. But then we go down to verse 7. And the Lord said to Gideon, with the 300 men who lapped, I will save you and give the Midianites into your hand. And let all the others go, every man to his home. So the people took provisions in their hands and their trumpets. And he sent all the rest of Israel, every man to his tent, but retained the 300. And the camp of Midian was below him in the valley. You know, I don't know what's going to happen in the future. I said it before a few months ago when we saw Hamas go into Israel and massacre people. And I said it then, I said, within a month, the world's going to hate Israel. And all you do is watch the news. Yesterday, we saw that there was drones and missiles sent from Iran. And some of you might say, well, that's across the world. What does that have to do with me? Yeah, I remember I said that about COVID too. When COVID came out and you started seeing the news in China, I said, what's that got to do with me? I don't even eat Chinese food. Oh, but it affected us. How do you think world wars begin? It all starts from a little incident, something small. Because here's the thing, Israel has nuclear power. Iran is fighting to get nuclear power. And Israel has said, if there's any real threat, we're not afraid. And we will do what we have to do. Now here's the problem though, is Iran is allied with Russia, who has nuclear power. Tomorrow's not promised. And we live in a scary world. And with that, I'm not trying to preach to people that want fast food. I'm going to be honest with you. I don't want to preach to people that want fast food. I want to preach to people that want a home-cooked meal. I want to preach to people that really want to hear the voice of God. I want to preach to people that are really crying out for the Spirit of God upon them. I want to preach to people that are saying, Lord, this is my house, is your house, Lord. Let your dwelling place be here in my home. My children are yours. My marriage is yours. My life is yours. I don't have time to entertain 10,000 people in Modesto. And you shouldn't have time for that either. Because we are here to build up leaders. Because tomorrow's not promised. And we got to be able to reach those that are lost. We got to be able to reach them, because you know what? You and I cannot change the way the world is going. We can't change. I can't call up presidents or governors or nothing. And most likely you can't either. So quit trying to get the church to wake up. No, the church needs to get saved. Because regardless of what happens, people need to get saved. Because you or I cannot change the outcome of this world. This thing could blow over tomorrow, or it can escalate within tonight. We don't know. And if it doesn't, then another thing will happen, and another thing will happen. Because in the last days, there will be rumors of wars and wars. And Jesus says, these are signs of the end. And that's all we hear. God is not calling 32,000 here. God says, I want 300 who are alert. Who are alert. And I will raise them up, and you will see my hand move in a way that's never been moved before in Modesto, where revival will come, not from the biggest church, but from the biggest hearts. Lord God, I thank you for this moment and this time. Let us never go back to Egypt, Lord. But if we have to look back just as a reminder to see how far we've come, then so do it, Lord. Because so many here, we don't know. I don't know. Maybe they're feeling discouraged, but let them see how far they have come. We're opening the altar right now. This is a time to say, Lord, I feel like I'm not going anywhere. Lord, give them a vision of how far they've come. Let them see how far they've come. That their victory is one step forward, one step, one foot. It's right there. stop wandering in your desert for 40 years.
Trust in you now.
And just say, Lord, I'm ready. And he's going to say, son, daughter, I've been waiting for you to say that. Because I've been waiting for you for a long time. But I am with you. You can do all things through me who strengthens you, says the Lord. There is nothing impossible for God. Your family can be reached. Your daughter can be saved. Your son will be anointed. Your family will come together. Your household will have peace in it.
Thank you, Lord.
And God will do the impossible. Lord, remind them of how far they've come. Remind them of how far they've been. Lord, I don't know when it's my turn to go out that door into eternity. But from here to there, Lord, let every day matter in your kingdom. Let me bring as many as I possibly can, Lord. Let me reach as many as I possibly can. Let me use every breath, every heartbeat, Lord God, to exalt you. Because it is you that gives us our heartbeat. It is you that gives us our breath, Lord. Lord, I will not sit back and allow the kingdom of darkness to rule over this city and this land. I will not allow the kingdom of darkness to rule over my children or my grandchildren. I will intercede for them, Lord. And we will stand in the gap for our future generations. That whatever anointing you have on me, let it pour out to my children and my grandchildren and my great-grandchildren in the future, Lord. That what is being established here will last forever.
Thank you, Lord.
Do you trust in God?
I trust in you then. I trust in you now. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Blessed assurance. Jesus is mine.
Make these lyrics yours. Make this song yours.
He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood, and what he did for me on Calvary, more than enough. I trust in God, my Savior, the one.
He will never fail you.
Who will never fail.
He will never fail you.
He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail.
Yes, Lord. He's a generational God.
He'll never fail. Perfect submission. All is at rest.
He is victory. This is my story. This is my song.
And this is my song. I'm praising my risen King and Savior all the day long. trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail.
Make this next chorus, make this yours.
Thank you, Lord.
He hears you and he answers. He hears you when he answers. Yes, cry out, Lord, to him. He says, shout out to me. I will show you great and mighty things you never imagined.
I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord,
yes,
and he heard and he answered.
Cry out to God.
I sought the Lord.
He will hear
and he
you and he will
answered.
Answer.
I sought the Lord.
There is nothing impossible
heard,
for him.
And he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him, God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust in him. That's why I trust him. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. I sought the Lord and he heard and he answered. That's why I trust him. That's why I trust him.
Yes, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Lord, you are so good. You are amazing. You are worthy to be praised. It is you who stands alone. There's no one else but you. You are the way, the truth, and the life. You are the life. You are the life giver, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end. You are the good shepherd. You are the one that sits on a throne. You are the provider, Lord God. You are the restorer. You are all things. All of heaven worships you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for the generations in the past that have served you. Thank you for the generations in the future who will serve me because of what we pour into them, Lord. You know, when I was talking to my sister-in-law, with tears in her eyes, she says, I don't know what to do. I've lived my whole life, the last 22 years, with my husband, and now he's gone. And now I will never see him again alive on this earth. I will never. And I don't know what to do. And somebody told me that I need to follow the will of God. She goes, what's the will of God? And I explained to her about watching my friends leave that gate. And I said, we're all going to leave that gate. I said, but here's the will of God. Is that you seek after him. And you live your life seeking after him. And you raise your children seeking after him. I said, and here's the hope that we have. Because when Jason passed away, we found a journal of his prayers unto the Lord, prayers for his family. He believed in Jesus. And it's his will that you see him again. And that life on the other side of the gate is more real than this side of the gate. See, I was in a prison watching them walk outside. But you know what? This world might seem big, but it's a prison. And in this prison, there's sickness and trauma and disease. But someday we will come out of this gate. Someday our release date. It's not a death date. It's a release date. Because we can be released into glory. And Jesus says, I will wipe away every tear. And there will be no more sickness. There will be no more pain. And I will completely be there. I will be the light because there's no need for a sun because I'm the light. And he says, I have a mansion of many, I have a home of many mansions, and if it were not so, I wouldn't have told you so. And I will come to you myself and bring you with me. I said, the will of God is to seek after him, and he will add all other things unto you. I had friends that released before I did. And I remember it was my turn, and I was standing at the gate, and my heart was pounding because for the first time, it wasn't me watching somebody else. It was all my brothers, Brother Edwin, Brother Lorenzo, Brother Johnny Alcala. All them brothers were watching me, and I'm standing at the gate, and I look back one more time, and I remember waving at them very nervously because I was about to walk out of the gate, out of their life forever in this setting. And my heart was beating, and I was scared, and I heard the door buzz, and I stepped out of the door, stepped into freedom for the first time. And I remember walking a few steps, and I saw my mom and my dad come out of the car, and I saw my children come out of the car, and it was one of my son's birthdays, and he ran to me. He said, Daddy, this is the best birthday I've ever had in my whole life. Within minutes, I was in the arms of those that I loved. And I believe that somehow, some way, we're going to understand that in glory. And the longer I live, the more people I have on that side. And they're just waiting. The Bible says that we have a cloud of witnesses in heaven. They are cheering for you. Do you realize that? And I'm not talking about just the ones you loved. And I'm talking about Peter, King David, Jeremiah, Esther, Naomi, Ruth. Every time you're preaching the good word, they're cheering for you. When they see you destroying strongholds, they're cheering for you. Angels are cheering for you. Jesus is cheering for you. We do the will of God. That's what we do. If there's anyone here that you would like to give your life to the Lord, I don't care how late it is, because salvation is the most important thing we could ever do. I know it's 12:23. The taco truck's still going to be there, guys. But a salvation is more important. The Bible says all of heaven rejoices. If there's anyone here that would like to surrender your life to the Lord today, or those that are watching online, we're going to do it right now. We're going to wait for you, because this is the most important day of your life. And I'll be hungry a little bit longer if it's for your salvation. If there's anyone here, come up to the front or raise your hand. Anybody online, you can do this right now. And just repeat after me. And say, Lord God, I repent of all my sins. I believe you died on the cross. And after 3 days, you rose in power. Take out my heart of stone. Put in a heart of flesh. And put your spirit in me. I am yours. I surrender. From this day on, in Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. Let's give the Lord a hand. If you pray that prayer and you not only said it with your mouth, but believe it in your heart, the Bible says you will be saved. I pray over you that if you prayed that, I pray in the name of Jesus for anything demonic to break his chains from you. I declare freedom over your life right now. Any cloudiness of mind, I command clarity to come forth. Any spirit of addiction, suicide, drugs, or whatever it is, I command that filthy spirit to come out now. I pray that you love the word. I pray that you want to seek his face all the time. That you pray that I pray that you seek his word and his prayer, and that you worship and have a life of prayer and worship. The Bible says that you're the temple of God, and your house shall be a house of prayer. Lord, I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's give the Lord one more hand.
My Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail. I trust in God.
Amen, amen.
Amen, thank you.
I also want to remind you on this screen, on the next screen, if you could put Brother Rob's service of life. If anybody, if you want to help, please, we need your help. It's this Saturday. Those are the times. And he was a great, funny man, and it's hard to believe that he's not with us, but he's walked through that gate. He's walked through that gate and made it into eternity.
Amen.
So
amen.
If you can be a blessing and a help, please.
Yeah, just message me. You have my number. Message me, Facebook, whichever. Come talk to me, whichever works. Just let me know that you'll be present for that day. That'll be great. Thank you. God bless you, family. Worship team, don't forget I'll be meeting you here at the altar.